All right, now that we have a pretty thorough understanding of the atomic and molecular level of organization, we're going to move on to the cellular level with chapter 4, cell structure and function. In this chapter, we will be going over all of the sections, cellular level of organization, prokaryotic cells, eukaryotic cells, and then the different structures of the eukaryotic cells, like the nucleus and ribosomes, the endomembrane system, microbiotes and vacuoles, the energy-related organelles, and we'll finish off with the cytoskeleton. But first, we want to talk about sort of an overview of the cellular level of organization. So there was a detailed study of the cell in the 1830s, and this is where we got sort of this unifying concept in biology that originated from the work of biologists Schleiden and Schwann in 1838 and 39. And what they came up with was what we now refer to as cell theory. And that is that one, all organisms are going to be composed of cells. All cells come from only pre-existing cells because all cells are self-reproducing, and that cells are going to be the basic unit of structure and function in organisms. So, cells are the basic units of life. This just means that all of the chemistry and biomolecules that we discussed in Unit 1 are necessary, but they're insufficient to sustain life on their own. They must work together to form a cell. The cell is going to be the basic of unit of life, meaning that life does not truly begin or truly exist before the cellular level of organization. So prior to the cellular level, we have the atomic level, the molecular level, we even have like the organelle level, but it's not until we have a full and complete working cell do we have can we consider the unit alive. So all organisms are going to be made up of cells. When we observe plants, animals, and other organisms, it's important to realize that what we are seeing is a collection of cells that work together in a highly organized and regulated manner. This figure here shows the connections between the whole organism and their component cells. So here we have a leaf. Here we have a microscopic structure of a leaf where you can see that this leaf is actually composed of several layers. Here's the top of the leaf, the bottom of the leaf, and all of these are individual cells found within the leaf. Here we have skin tissue where we actually have multiple layers of cells stacked on top of each other to form tissues. So although the cellular basis of life is clear to us now, scientists were unaware of this fact as recently as 200 years ago. And really, we didn't begin to understand the cell until the invention of the microscope. And the reason for this is because cells are darn stinking small. They do tend to range in size, and there's a huge range all the way up from 1 millimeter down to 1 micrometer in diameter. But even still at 1 millimeter, they're still incredibly small and can really only be viewed clearly through the microscope. So if you've read this chapter, you should be able to answer the question, why are cells so small? The reason that cells are so small, this is actually a very necessary part of life, but the reason that cells are so small is because they need a very large surface area of plasma membrane to adequately exchange their material. All of the nutrients going into the cell go across the plasma membrane. All of the waste leaving the cell go across the plasma membrane. It's kind of like if you were able to breathe through your skin. You would be super efficient because you have all of that surface area that you could be breathing in and out of. The larger the surface area, the more efficiently the cells can exchange nutrients and waste. And so we're going to take a look at what we refer to as the surface area to volume ratio and how that relates to cellular efficiency. So we're going to take a look at this particular diagram, and I love this diagram. It does a really great job, I think, of explaining in numerically why cells have to be so small in order to be efficient. So what we have over here is 1 4-centimeter cube, and over here we have 64 1-centimeter cubes. Now the interesting thing is that when we have 1 4-centimeter cubed, the height times the width times the length times the number of cubes is going to be 64 centimeters cubed. When we have 64 centimeters, 1 inch, or 1 centimeter cubes, when we multiply the height by the width by the length by the number of the cubes, we also have 64 centimeters. In other words, we have the exact same volume, whether we have one massive cell or 64 little itty bitty cells, same volume. However, the surface area is different. The total surface area is going to be the height times the width times the number of sides times the number of cubes. And so what we're counting now is the number of sides. And in a one 4-centimeter cube, we have 96 centimeters squared for the total surface area. However, when we have 64 1-centimeter cubes, we have so many more sides to count, so many more sides throughout these 64 1-centimeter cubes. So our surface area is actually going to be 384. So if we compare the surface area to the volume, if we have a large cell, we have a surface area to volume of 1.5 to 1. With 64 individual little itty bitty cubes, we actually have a surface area to volume ratio of 6 to 1. We have much more surface area to volume ratio. Another way that you can think about this is think about a Reese's peanut butter cup. Now, I personally am not a big fan of peanut butter, so I'm just taking this on faith based on what I've been told by my siblings. But my sister swears that the very best Reese's peanut butter cups are going to be those Easter eggs that come out around in the spring. They're going to be like, they're peanut butter cups, but they're really large. And the reason for this, or the reason why she likes those more, is because they have a smaller chocolate to peanut butter ratio. The bigger the inside, the bigger the interior volume, the more peanut butter you have to chocolate. The smaller Reese's peanut butter cups, think of the itty bitty Reese's peanut butter cups that you can actually find in the baking chip aisle. If you eat a handful of those, is it going to taste exactly like a giant peanut butter cup? No. They're not going to taste the same. They have the exact same type of chocolate. The peanut butter recipe is the same. The ingredients are all the same, but the ratio is different. The itty bitty chocolate peanut butter cups have a much higher chocolate to peanut butter ratio. So if that helps you out, there you go. If it doesn't help, just look at this diagram. But what we want is a very high surface area to volume ratio. We want a lot of chocolate for a little bit of peanut butter. And that's how we can increase the efficiency of the cell. So here I'm going to just put that into words. The surface area to volume ratio requires that cells be small. The smaller they are, the greater the surface area to volume ratio and the greater efficiency that cell will have. Large cells have a decreased surface area to volume ratio. If there's decreased surface area to volume, we have a decreased efficiency. Small cells have an increased surface area to volume ratio, therefore they have an increased efficiency. So that's going to be it for our overview on cells. Next, we're going to divide our cells into two categories, prokaryotic and eukaryotic cells, and we're going to start to look at some of their structural characteristics.